president of the Essential Bible Ministries. The aim of this non-denominational Christian ministry is to help people of all ages meet God in the Bible and prayer. Mr. Kuniholm has written several books, including The Essential Jesus, The Essential Question, John, an Eyewitness Account of the Son of God, and perhaps his most popular, The Essential 100, which is a book of the key 100 verses of the Bible. Mr. Kuniholm is also a frequent speaker at churches and Christian conferences and writes a blog, theessentialbibleblog.com. Prior to his work at Essential Bible Ministries, Mr. Kuniholm was president of the Scripture Union USA for 19 years, which is a worldwide ministry, executive vice president for Prison Fellowship Ministries, and served as chairman of the Formative Bible Agencies. Mr. Kuniholm and his wife, Carol, have three grandchildren, and live near Philly and are members of Church of Good Samaritans down the road in Paoli. Please welcome Mr. Kuniholm's church home.
Scripture, and there's a lot of things we can talk about, but we're just going to make it quick here. is he's kind of, it's sort of like a doorknob conversation. You know what a doorknob conversation is? So you're talking to somebody, maybe your advisor or a professor or a teacher or something, and there's something that you want to say, and you're kind of hemming and hawing, and when you're just about to leave and your hand is on the doorknob, you finally say what you really came to say. And that's what this is. It's Paul's doorknob conversation, the last thing he wants to say to Timothy. And there are two kind of points that he makes. And they're both in verse 14, kind of in a throwaway sentence. He says, but as for you, continue in what you learn. And you think, well, then he's going to get to the bottom line. No, he's already given him the bottom line. And that first phrase, but as for you, he's kind of pivoting. What he said prior to this is, avoid evil. Avoid, there's all kind of evil people around you. And all kind of people doing all kinds of stuff. But as for you, you need to make a choice to go in a different direction. Ahead of time, you need to make that choice. But as for you, you're going to pivot and go the other way. And the second thing he says is continue in what you have learned. Continue in what you have learned. And you know, young people often let things slide as they get older. In fact, statistics say that. Did you know that when people leave high school, they often leave their faith? That's what statistics say. I doubt that will happen to anyone here with the way you've been mentored and the kind of grounding that you've gotten here. But statistics say people often let their faith slide when they make that transition from high school to college. And what Paul is saying, your mentor is saying, continue in what you learn. Make a commitment to stay with it. And the key thing he says that's going to help you, and I don't know if you heard this when I read it, is Holy Scripture. That's the secret ingredient. That's the active ingredient. The thing that's going to help you stay strong, continue in your faith, and I would say continue in a life that's productive and effective. So because of that, because the Holy Scriptures, because the Bible, what your mentor is saying here, that's the key, that's the foundation for life going forward. I want to give you a challenge this morning. And if you don't remember anything else that I say this morning, remember this. My challenge is that before you graduate from the church farm school, I want to challenge you to read the world's most important book, the Bible, before you graduate. Now that's a big challenge, I know. That's a tough challenge. You've got a million books that you've got to read already, and I've just stacked another one on top of it. But why do I say that? Well, the Bible is undeniably the greatest book in all of world history. And if you haven't read the world's greatest book, the world's most important book, there's something missing in the fantastic education that you're getting. Now you can say, well, wait a minute. You know, I'm reading all these great books. How can you say the Bible is the greatest? Well, if you look at it based on sales, the Bible has sold more copies than any other volume in history. You know, if there's books that have sold 100 million copies or more, like Don Quixote, that's 100 million seller. Or more recently, the Harry Potter books, there's a bunch of them, but the first one, over 100 million. You go up higher, there's another line, books that have sold 1 billion. And there's only a few of them, like the sayings of Chairman Mao, the little red book. You know, this sold 1 billion copies. The Bible has sold, that they can count, over 6 billion. And that doesn't even count the ones that have been given away or the ones that are online. The Bible blows away every other book in terms of sales. It's the King Kong of the publishing world. They don't even list it anymore on the New York Times bestseller because it's just number one. But that's just sales. What about influence? Well, the Bible has influenced just about everything in our culture, art, laws, literature. You can't go through your education without understanding all the biblical allusions and all the biblical references. It's what our society, our Western society, is based on. But maybe you're wondering, yeah, okay, fine, you know. Bible sold a lot. You know, yeah, okay, art, literature, all that stuff. But isn't the real issue, is it true? How do we know that? That's not a question you often ask in chapel, is it? Is the Bible really true? Well, I've done some research and some reading on that, and I'm not going to go deep into this, but I'm going to give you a place to go if that's a question you have. I wrote an article on my blog called Top 10 Reasons the Bible is True. And that was by far the most widely distributed one. It went viral. So I wrote a second one called Top 10 Myths About the Bible and Why They're Bogus. And all I did was put out the evidence for why the Bible is true. I put out the reason, I quoted the best expert on that topic, and I cited the source. Top 10 Reasons the Bible is True, Top 10 Myths About the Bible. If you want, go check it out. EssentialBibleBlog.com. But what you find when you look at the evidence is that there's far more evidence for the reliability of the biblical manuscripts than even things like Plato, Aristotle, and Socrates. Documents that no one questions. You do your homework, you find out that the Bible is not only the bestseller, the most influential, but it's the most reliable document we have in all of history. Okay, so the Bible is great, and I'm challenging you to read it, but maybe you're thinking, oh man, you know, another thing I gotta do. This guy comes in here and tries to guilt me into reading the Bible. And you know what? Okay, fine, you're right. Amen for reading the Bible, but truth is, why in the world would I ever want to do that? You know, I got a million other things to do. Give me some good reasons why I should read the Bible. And I would say that's a fair question. So with the time that I've got remaining here, I want to give you four good reasons why you should read the Bible today. And to do that, what I want to do is I want to steal or plagiarize or borrow a phrase from the Philadelphia Inquirer, you know, the paper in town. Now, most of us don't get our news from the physical paper anymore. We get it online or whatever. But the Philadelphia Inquirer used this phrase in their marketing called the Philadelphia Inquirer, it's how you know. It's how you know about the news. It's how you know about the weather. It's how you know about the sports. The Inquirer is how you know about everything that the Inquirer and their advertisers want you to know about. And I think that's a good phrase for the Bible, because the Bible is how you know about the most important things in this life and the next. So let me see if I can use that phrase and give you four good reasons why you should read the Bible today. Now the first reason is because the Bible is how you know about God. It's how you know about God. Let me ask you something. If you or somebody you know wants to know about God, who are you going to call? Right? Ghostbusters. Right? Not going to get far with that. But see, the thing about the Bible, it's our greatest single source of information about God. Now, theologians call it God's self-revelation. He's shown us who he is in the Bible. And as you read the different stories and you read the different accounts that are in there, what you're finding out is how God responds to humans and how God has interacted with human history. But it's not just the facts about God. The Bible is also a personal account of God. Now, I've brought some really high-tech special effects here to try to make my points. And my first high-tech special effect is one of my journals. Now, I'm an occasional journalist. You know, every 2 or 3 days I'll write something in the journal. This is one of my old ones. Now I do it on my iPad. But I write in my journal, and if you read my journal, you'll find out what I'm thinking about. And if you read this journal, you'll find out what makes me angry. And if you read this journal, you'll find out what I love and who I love. Now, I'm not going to let you read my journal. find out what makes them tick. And that's what the Bible is like. You know, there's all kinds of stories in there. And there's all kinds of history and poetry and lots of different things. But as you read this, you're reading God's journal. You're finding out what He thinks about this world. So if you want to know God, you need to read His book. Now the second reason for reading the Bible, it's how you know about salvation. It's how you know about salvation. Now, let me just say something. All of us here today have a problem. It's the same problem. And you know what it is. It's called sin. The things we do to disobey God's law. And our sin separates us from God. That's the bad news. The good news is that from the very beginning, God put in motion a remedy for that problem. And the remedy culminated in Jesus Christ when He died on the cross and rose again. That's the answer. That's the good news. And the Bible, from beginning to end, tells that story. And you know, that's the one big storyline that holds the whole Bible together. And once you realize that, that's what makes sense of the historical books. That's what makes sense of the wisdom literature. That's what makes sense of the gospel. That's what makes sense of the letters. All of them are developing that one storyline that God put in a plan of salvation that includes you. Now, to help make that point, I've got another high-tech special effect here. And it's one of these magic picture books. You ever seen one of these? So what it is it's these full color pictures, you know, of this one's a butterfly or some flowers or just a pattern. And what you do is like, let me turn to ones like this one is, well, there's just a lot of patterns. Here's one, okay, it's a field with some, with a fence in front of it. And if you stare at that picture, you just let your eyes focus, all of a sudden, another picture emerges off the page, a three-dimensional picture. It's a horse, or a star, or whatever. Have you seen these? And once you see the picture in the picture, once the 3D picture emerges, that's all you see. You don't see this picture anymore. You just see the picture embedded in the picture. And that's what it is with the Bible. Once you realize that the big story of the Bible is the story of salvation, everywhere you look, that's the 3D picture that emerges from the page. There's a third reason, and it's called, you read the Bible because it's how you know about living. Now, a lot of people, this is what frustrates them about the Bible. They say, oh man, you know, it's just a rule book. You know, a bunch of these and thous and do's and don'ts. And that's what I don't like about the Bible. You know, tell me all the things, you know, what I want to do, I can't do. And what I'm already doing, I'm not supposed to do. So why would I read that thing? I want to be free. I want to live a free life. That's what I want. And the Bible stops me from it. You know what? I would say that's the reverse of the truth. That's the exact opposite of reality. Because the Bible is the way, and reading the Bible and living the Bible is the way to live a happy life, a free life. And my example for this one is this is a computer manual. Actually, it's hard to find a computer manual anymore because they're all online, right? So this is it's an owner's manual for a laser printer, but we're going to think of this as a manual for a computer. Now think about the computer. I'm sure you all have laptops or some kind of device. And you have incredible freedom to use that laptop or computer any which way you want, right? You can go into the control panel, and you can click any one of those icons. And you can go all the way over to the right, to the advanced tab, the one you're not supposed to mess with unless you really know what you're doing. And you can set those settings any which way you want. You're free to do that. But if you don't use your laptop or your computer in the way that the manufacturer designed it, pretty soon it's going to be messed up. You're going to be really frustrated. And you need the owner's manual to reset the default settings, don't you? Well, the same is true with the Bible. And And the same is true with our lives. God has given you freedom to live your life any which way you want. You can go into the control panel of your heart, and you can click generosity, or you can click greed. You're free to do that. You can go into the icons in your heart, and you can click love, or you can click lust. You're free to do that. But if you don't live your life the way your Creator designed you, pretty soon your life is going to be messed up. And that's why you need the Bible. Because it's going to help you reset the default settings of your heart and your life so you can live the abundant, joyful life that your Heavenly Father created you for. And that's why I say it's the reverse of what most people think. They think it's stopping me from the life I want to live, and I would contend it's the only way to get there. Well, there's one last reason. You know, I've been using this thing, it's how you know. So the reasons to read the Bible today, it's how you know about God, it's how you know about salvation, it's how you know about living. And I have to sort of change it at the end here, because it's how you can meet God every day. Now think about what I just said. It's reading the Bible is how you can meet God every day. Now, I don't know about you, but if God exists, and I believe he does, then I want to meet him. I want to experience him. I don't want to play games. I don't want to punch the clock for God. If God is real, somehow I want to know him. Don't you? And what I've discovered is that this thing, this Bible, this book, is the best way I've found for me interacting with, sensing God's presence every day. And the problem is most people say, it's boring. You know, why? How? Come on. It's a boring, thick old book. The reason why people say that is because they've never discovered the secret that makes the Bible come alive. And I discovered the secret that makes the Bible come alive a bunch of years ago. And this is, I had a job at a summer camp. I was a little bit older than, I was about 20 years old, so maybe a little bit older than you guys. And I got a job at a summer camp in Maryland, not too far from here, about an hour's drive. It was a summer job. And it was a good job, and I'll tell you why. Because this summer camp was a girls' camp, okay? So I'm the maintenance guy at a girls' camp. Good job, right? And the funny thing is, I'm not a very good handyman. And years later, I said to my wife, I don't know why they gave me that job. You know, I guess I was just good with people. She said, what do you mean by that? And but I was the maintenance man at the girls' camp. And during that summer, and you know what was great? 200 girls. You know, I'm the maintenance man. 200 counselors, you know, campers, and the whole deal. So it was real ego there. Well, during that summer, I started to get letters from a girl in New York. And for reasons that I'm going to explain, I kept those letters a secret. Now, the other part of my job that summer was I had to supervise the kitchen boys. And so they were guys about your age. And they were, you know, they were supposed to do the dishes, and I was supposed to keep track of them. And I guess at a girls' camp, they figured, well, if there's dirty work to, you know, be done around here, duh, get the boys to do it. That was sort of their attitude. And but my job was to try to get these boys, you know, to wash dishes and read the Bible and not think about the 200 girls. Okay? Didn't work very well. I mean, I would tell them, oh, come on, guys. You know, in your free time, go for a walk, you know, get some fresh air, you know, don't think about the girls. You know, all they would do, I remember they would come back to the cabin, and they would wash the dishes, they'd come back to the cabin, and they would lift weights. You know, mostly curls, you know, because at, you know, 14 years old, these guys had already figured out what women want, okay? What women want is a man with brains, you know, real brains. And that's all they would do. And I knew that if I told them that I was getting letters from a girl in New York, they would get on my case big time. could say, you tell us not to be so girl crazy, but look at you. The truth is, I love getting those letters. You ever get a letter here that's fat? Thick envelope, I loved it when the envelope I got from her was thick. You know, because it meant she had a lot to say to me. And I used to open the letters in secret, and I just loved her handwriting. She had this small handwriting, I just loved to look at it. And I loved to read what she was doing in New York. You know, all the different things. And I think back on those letters, and I think, what was it that made those letters so exciting to me? You know, was it the length of the letter, or the style of the writing, or what they were all about? I mean, well, that was part of it. But I think what made those letters come alive to me was that somewhere far, far away, there was a beautiful girl with long brown hair who loved a tall, lanky boy like me. What made the letters come alive was the person on the other end. That's the secret that makes the Bible come alive. You can read the Bible to get Bible knowledge. You can read the Bible to learn biblical theology, and all of that stuff is good. But most of all, you read the Bible to meet the person, the author, the God of the universe who's not so very far, far away, the God who made you, the God who wants to relate to you, the God who loves you more than you could ever think or imagine. That's the secret that makes the Bible come alive. By the way, the girl in New York I was writing letters to, 3 years later, we got married. And Carol and I have been married for 39 years. How many of you have heard of Dietrich Bonhoeffer? He's a German theologian, was martyred for his faith by the Nazis. He said this, think of the Bible as God's love letter written personally to you. Think of the Bible as God's love letter written personally to you. So I want to end with the challenge that I began with. Before you graduate from the church farm school, I want to challenge you to read the world's most important book. Because as you pray it in and live it out, it'll change your life and you'll meet with God every day. I want to add a P.S. to that, and I want to give you some practical help with that. You know, because the Bible is a tough read sometimes, so I'm going to give you, Gary referred to it, it's a little reading plan. It's called the Essential 100. It's 100 passages, 50 in the Old Testament, 50 in the New Testament. They're short passages. If you read this, it's 17% of the Bible, but it's like the express lane. You'll get the big story fast. You won't get bogged down. And I will guarantee you something. If you try this, this is the fastest and most exciting way to read through the Bible you've ever tried. This is the way you won't fail. You'll make it through this. And I'll tell you another fun thing. It's got these little punch-outs. So every time you do one of the readings, you punch out one of the things. And, you know, Bible purists say, oh, man, I don't need that. I'm telling you, do the first one, punch out the little thing, you're hooked. You'll do it, I guarantee you. And I put some up here for you to take, but try it. And you know what? Over 5 million people have done it, and it's spread around the world. I would love to see that take off here at the Church Farm School. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for this day. I thank you for these young men, the faculty, for the staff, the leadership here. Lord, I pray that you would ignite a Bible reading revival that begins here at the Church Farm School and spreads in this region to other schools and far and wide. I pray in Jesus' name.